Hello, welcome to VHDL Lectures. My name is Lajim Lalwal, and today we'll be discussing VHDL designs. The outline for today includes design flow for FPGAs, available design tools, and what does an FPGA or other types of gates, array, programmable gates look like. To implement designs, digital designs on FPGA, we need an environment, a software environment where we can enter the specifications, the design. For example, if you'd like to implement a multiplexer or some other complicated digital designs. So we need a software environment for this. We call this step design entry. And then after implementing our design, according to the specification, we like to simulate and verify within this software environment and kind of debug and see that it works according to specifications. If it doesn't, we modify the design again, and then we iterate continuously. It can be stepwise, so we can start with a small and simple design, and then we modify that until it becomes complicated or it fulfills all the design scope. So after simulation and iterative debugging until we are satisfied, then we can implement this design on a logic synthesizing platform. For example, we can go to the laboratory or to the workshop and plug forward, bring out the components that we need, wire them together, connect them, and verify that it actually works in reality. So these steps of transferring the design onto implementation platform can be done manually by going to the workshop and bringing the components, or it can be done automatically, especially if you are using an FPGA platform that can help you to do all the place and routing and fitting the components and fitting into the library of the vendor that you are familiar with or you prefer. So which tools can we use to automatically fit our design into an FPGA? These available tools are like design environment. So if we have a single environment, we can have our VHDL entry, we can have our test bench and other things that we need to actually build this design. All these design entries which are implemented in VHDL or in some other interfaces can be simulated together, and then from the waveform analysis you get satisfied. So within the same software environment, the same design tool, we can actually have a good idea, even behaviorally, and even the timing diagrams or post place and route simulation and verification of what the design might look like. So after all this has been satisfied, then we like to synthesize it. And to synthesize, we need constraints. We need to be able to have an idea of what kind of technology platform we like to implement in, which kind of vendor we like to have, and what are the available components of on this FPGA device that we like to use. So we also kind of want to be able to fulfill some requirements on the timing. So maybe you have a minimum requirement on how fast or how slow the clock can be. So after synthesis, then we need to fit it into a particular size of gate array so that it doesn't take unnecessarily large components that can be having very drastic impact on the cost of the synthesis. So from this viewpoint, we have a fitted implementation, so which we can call gate list, and then that can be automatically placed on the target device, and even that can also be simulated to have a good idea of what will happen in reality. So after downloading into the FPGA, we probably don't have the opportunity to simulate or to have a debugging interfaces any longer on all the gates and all the components and all the signals. But before we download, we can actually do what we call post layout, post place and seize timing simulation, and all those kind of stuff, even within your software environment before downloading to FPGA. So now we have a design which we have implemented. We like to download it into a programmable logic array. For now, we've been calling this kind of things FPGA, but the general idea is that we have a couple of gates. They are arranged into a matrix or an array, and they are possible to be programmed as many times as we like. So we have an idea that says that this can be prefabricated logic blocks or gates, and that the technology is simply like that. We have a group of inputs that can be manipulated or arranged or grouped together using an AND matrix, and then the product or the combination of this grouping can be fed out into an OR matrix, and then we get an output. So you have a logic you manipulated, and then this logic will generate for you combinations of inputs that can be added together to give combinations of the output. So in reality, what we need is a block of non-gates or NAND gates, the circuits to be configured, and how the configuring can be done. These are the things that can be captured and can be programmed in a programmable logic array. So what does a matrix of programmable array looks like? Here is an example. We have an OR plane, an AND plane, and we have an OR plane. At the beginning, everything is connected, but all the inputs and the inverses of the inputs, they are all ANDed together, and the outputs of all these AND gates are also connected together to the OR gates. So it's just like a white platform that everything goes in and everything comes out before programming. But what happens after programming is that we have fuses or anti-fuses technology in this system that can be the fuses can be blown up, in which case they are connected before, and now after blowing up they are removed. Or we have anti-fuses system, in which case there is no connection, and that after programming we make the connection. Okay, so here is an example in which case we can, from inputs A and B and C, we can generate a few outputs that looks okay. So now we have what blocks and programmable gates looks like. Now when you have, with technology increasing, you have more possibilities of putting all these gates array together. And when you do that, when you put all this together, they become a little bit more complicated, and you have more possibilities to implement more designs. So what we now have is that each block is a simple gate with a few transistors that can implement all this AND matrix and OR matrix planes connected together. But then these are simple implementations that they can be connected together a lot. And then do this, we need the interconnects that route from one series of gates to another gate to another gate until you get a very complicated implementation or complex implementation that fulfills your objective. And of course, you have a lot more I/O interfaces also, so you have more possibilities or more connectivity to the external world and for your input and for the output. And of course, you, from the interconnects, it means that the output of one logic block can be connected to another logic block. And the programming, of course, is still the same thing. So it can be SRAM based, in which case the connection and then the mapping or the functionality of each logic block is stored locally, or it can be permanently programmed. So we have maxed implementation. As technology grows, then we have more possibility for all these things to be implemented on a single FPGA device. So with advancement in technology, we started with simple gate array, and now we come to complex programmable logic devices, popularly known as PLDs, and then we move even with technology, into FPGAs, field programmable gate arrays. And of course, the basic idea is that they are all implementation of array logics that are programmable, and they have complex and more interesting components available that can be plugged and used easily. So here is the trend from a few gates in programmable array logic into FPGA. You'd start moving from 10 to 100 gates into millions of gates per FPGA or per device. So it's a technology trend that at a more and more complex gates can be put together to implement complicated devices and complicated logic. So different vendors, FPGA vendors, have their own families of FPGA, and each of them offer different things. I can just mention briefly here that Actel, for example, have a fuse based FPGA that's really, really low power, especially the static power, especially when it's in a sleep mode, if you can call it like that. It draws very little current. But the other that are SRAM based, they draw more current, but they offer more flexibility and more programmability, and they have a wider range of components that can be used. So you can do a lot with Altera and Xilinx, but then you pay a lot on energy consumption. So this is what a classic FPGA looks like. You have your blocks of programmable logic. They are connected with interconnects, obviously, and then you have I/O pins to connect to the external world. And if we zoom in to a segment on what an FPGA from Xilinx looks like, then we can start seeing this like a digital clock manager. You have different forms of I/O banks, then you have a different logic or different standard for the IOs. You have they call their own configurable logic block. They have block RAMs, they have multipliers, they have different clock networks, so they have different clock regions, and the configuration is based on local SRAM storage of what each logic block should implement. So on a larger view, this is what it looks like. You have a block RAMs and then multipliers standing next to each other, being placed next to each other. You have a clock regions and clock buffers at strategic locations. So there is a difference between I/O pins and clock pins because of the buffering and because of the global routing. So you have a interconnect and a configurable logic block. So this is what it looks like on typical Xilinx FPGA. And of course, when you zoom in on what an interconnect can look like, or what a configurable logic block looks like, then you start seeing things like a switch max that, when programmed, it defines from which logic block to which logic block and which signals can be carried and how many signals. So it's the interconnect. It's a web, a net of routing connectivities from a lot of block RAMs to another large set of block RAMs, in which case a lot of I/O pins are available and connected everywhere. And then we need to program the switch matrices of a lot of these interconnects in order to be able to write output of one logic block to the input of another logic block. So that's so much that we have for discussion today. Thanks for joining us, and now we know a little bit more about how to implement an FPGA and what we can expect in a classical off-the-shelf standard FPGA. And thank you for joining us.